Welcome to Train Masters Productions. Today we will be reviewing this Vision Line Amtrak 926 GG1. So, let's get rolling. Before we talk about Lionel's version of the GG1, let's talk about the real version. The GG1 was built, the first GG1s were built in 1934 at Altoona Shops. All GG1s were built at Altoona Shops by the PRR themselves, but I think another company was involved, Fairbanks Morse or Baldwin? I'm not sure. Maybe Baldwin? I'm not sure though. But the last ones were built in 1943 and they were used on the PRR for express passenger service. And after the PRR merged with New York Central, they became the Penn Central, and they ran there, and then they failed big time. Wait, how big was the fail? Anyway, yes, the fail was pretty big. However, they ran on Conrail and Amtrak. Now, before the GG1s, they used P5s, they were going to use the P5s, but the P5s struck. One time, an engineer was killed when the P5 had struck a truck, and it was a box cab, so they used streamline engines. However, they needed to lash them up to get to pull a big train. It just wasn't very convenient. However, with the GG1, you could just use one engine, and they had a top speed of 100 miles per hour. 16 GG1s are preserved. I've actually seen a few of them. I've seen Amtrak 926 here. Actually, that's what my banner is, my channel banner. I also have seen 4934, I have a model of that. It's nicknamed Blackjack because all of its numbers add up to 21. I've seen 4800 old rivets. Because it was riveted. There's also 4899. I haven't seen it though. There is 913 at the Roanoke VMT. However, fun fact, the GG1s were last used on the New Jersey Transit, and they were being ran in Perth Amboy. And I've actually been in that spot, but never seen one. I've never seen one run. However, the GG1s, none are operational because they had PCBs in their transformers. And the one in best condition is 4934, and it's in pretty good shape. It's shiny. 4800 and 4934 are both at Strasburg in the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania. And this engine here, its original number, I think was 4930 something. I'm not sure what it was though. Then it was renumbered to 4926, then 926. But they were planning to repaint 926. They're planning to repaint it to back to the original paint scheme. And I personally really like the Amtrak paint scheme, but some people really don't like it. I don't know why, but some people really don't like it. Now that we've talked about the history of Amtrak, well, not Amtrak, the real GG1s, let's talk about the model. This engine came in 6 road numbers. It actually came in 7, so they had Penn Central riveted, Penn Central welded, riveted in 4899, 4800, and Conrail Bicentennial 4800, Amtrak 926, Penn Central, PRR, Tuscan Red, 5 stripe, 1 stripe, a lot of engines to choose from. This was from the 2016 Volume 1 catalog. So now we've talked about some history on the model and the real version, let's take a closer look. Here is a view of the front truck. You have brake equipment, Timken roller bearings, and there's a small F meaning front. Here is some grill, like the grill, not grill, like an air vent in the 926 row number. By the way, one thing I needed to mention, I thought of this now, and I didn't mention before in the history, that one blizzard caused snow, very fine snow, to enter the ducts, and it would melt in the traction motors and short them out, and it caused a lot of damage to happen, and half of them to be taken out of service. So Amtrak had moved the ducts up here, but on others, you might find it down here. Now, I might be reviewing the Amtrak one, but this applies to all of them. You might have cosmetic differences, you might have different crew talk because it's road number specific. For example, Amtrak 926 clears the block, or for example, Conrail 4800 coming through the block like that. But you might also have different paint schemes too, because, well, if you have the same paint scheme for different road numbers, like if you had a Pennsylvania engine with this paint scheme, it would not look prototypical at all. But in the inside, it's the same. Here's the engineer side of the cab, and there's crew figures. There's also a crew figure on the fireman's side. There's a door actually opens. That's so cool. And also, you can see angle into the control panel, and there's actually light in there, and you can actually like see throttle details. That's really cool. Here's the middle of the train. You can see the drive wheels and Amtrak logo, blue stripe. Here's the back, and you can see the other truck, the rear truck, drivers, security bars, and windshield wipers, separately applied windshield wipers and bar. Here's the rear pantograph, and the rear pantograph goes up, and usually a way to lower them is using the shutdown sequence, but I prefer not to use a shutdown sequence. So how do you get them down? What you do is you turn the transformer up a little so it's enough to lower the pantographs, but not to start the engine again. Note that this will not work in conventional mode like a transformer. This only works in command mode like, say, Bluetooth or Legacy or TMCC, although command in traditional sense usually means with a remote like Legacy, Bluetooth. Not Bluetooth, Legacy, TMCC. You could, if you like heavily modify it, you could make it DCS, but here's a pantograph, and it has a little bulb in there. And what's that for? Well, on some GG1s, you could actually hook it up to a catenary system and run it off of catenary power. Now, with this one, you can't. And come to think of it, at first, it may seem pretty inconveniencing, but the track has three rails, like three of them. Yeah. And you have a pickup on the rail. So, the command, or the power, not command, the catenary arc lighting, no, the catenary system isn't really necessary. And plus, I don't have a catenary system. If I had it on my layout, it would be very, very inconvenient. Plus, if you had a catenary system, it would drive the price up, like, really high, like, a lot. Yes, it would be very expensive, and it'd be pretty expensive, and plus, now with real electric trains, I've watched real trains combine with electric trains, you can see them sparking, and it's a great view. It looks so cool, but on this engine, it doesn't really spark, but to simulate sparks, you can see this little bulb, and that's what it's for. It's a catenary arc lining effect, and how it works is it flickers to simulate a flickering, and it's on the front bulb too, not front bulb, on the front pantograph too, and if you raise both of them to simulate a de-icing mode, you can actually have both of them sparking. And it's pretty cool, but it's really cool. These pantographs are motorized. Do not lower them. You should avoid lowering them by hand, but do not. Seriously, don't. Like, really don't. But, like, do not raise them by hand. That could damage the pantograph or the motor, and that could be very bad. So don't do that. Here's the back door. It has a door, opens. You can see a nice drop plate. Now it has an O-gauge coupler, so you can actually, like, there's a gap if you lash them up, but with scale couplers, you wouldn't. And I guess you could convert them to scale couplers, but this is an electro coupler, and it can be fired from a Legacy or TFCC remote. On the other side, it might be difficult to see, but there's a small seam through the middle, and the seam, usually, it was a mistake from casting it, but usually you would grind down the seam from casting it, but since it hadn't been very well sanded down, there's a seam in the middle of it, and the video might make it look very bad, but it's hardly visible, and it's most noticeably there when you touch it, but you could leave it alone like I do, or you could use a Dremel tool or sandpaper and sand it down yourself. Now, I wouldn't recommend that because it's going to be hard finding some paint that matches this, but in theory, you could. Also, here's the top pantographs, a little hatch. Now, it opens. Nothing's in there, though. Here's the panel. And here are some hatches. Run program switch, if you're programming it. Smoke, no smoke. Pantograph, run or lock. In run mode, you can use them. In lock, it'll lock them in their current position with command. But in conventional, it'll lower them back down and lock them. Then we have Ketner arc on off. Pantograph, run, lock. Smoke, no smoke. And run program. Master volume knob, if you're running conventionally. Or the command volume's all the way up. Okay, so one more thing I wanted to talk about is a problem that's been on this engine, and it is a problem with the motor, and some GG1s don't have this problem, and some do. Well, I think all GG1s, I'm not sure if all GG1s have the problem or just some. Mine has this problem. So what happens is that my engine's, the gears are apparently too tight, and that's causing the engine to overheat, and for a safety feature to prevent it from damaging itself because of overheat, it stalls. And for some reason, it always stalls on this curve. Not the other ones, just this one. I don't know why, but it does. Also, but there are some solutions. You could A, take the engine apart and loosen the gears. Just, like, loosen them. Or you could wear them down. You could speed up this process by, like, sanding them, but I wouldn't recommend doing that. You could also, you could also run it in reverse for a really long time. Not really long time, you just want to run it in reverse and then in forward to loosen the gears so the stalling is less. I thought it was like a computer problem since it was always in the same spot. It wouldn't respond to commands. I saw the headlight flashing. I don't know why I did that, but apparently O-gauge, I learned that from O-gauge forum, and it's not only me, it's other GG1s, so, but if this doesn't work for your GG1, send it to get repaired or get it repaired. Okay, so that's the end of this review. I'm the Model Train Master, and I'll see you next time.